minutes too, yeah, until we start.
So we're now live. And
yeah. So we're just about ready to start, I think.
Yeah, people are still trickling into the chat.
Yeah. Participants, yeah. So welcome everyone to this World Localization Day webinar. And we have with us people from the program. I hope many of you who are tuning in today have watched the program. And so if you've seen some of our speakers, you can ask specific questions of them. So first of all, I want to introduce Henry Coleman, who works with us and who will be helping.
Happy
30th birthday, Abby. Hey everyone, I'm Henry. I'm with Local Futures. I hope you've all enjoyed seeing the program today. I've enjoyed dipping in and out of it.
So Henry, you were going to mention to people about ideally.
Yeah. So, okay. I'll do some general housekeeping to start us off with. First of all is we have the chat box on the right-hand side of the screen. If you want other people, like other participants, to see what you type into the chat box, you actually have to change. There's a little where it says two, just above where you type, you change that to all panelists and attendees to make sure everyone sees it. Otherwise it will be default set to all panelists. So only we'll see it. You can also let us know where you're from in the chat box. It's nice to get an idea of where people are coming from. Thank you all so much for joining. And then you can also put your questions in the chat box. So anything that's come up for you while watching the program, perhaps directed at specific speakers or something more generally. And then the last thing I wanted to note was if people could consider signing up to the International Alliance for Localization, signing our Global to Local Declaration, and consider pledging action in our 10,000 Actions campaign, which are all presented on the World Localization Day website. Those are the tangible outcomes of this event. So I hope you'll consider. We're getting so many people putting where they're coming in, where they're from. Actually, we have a lot of people logged in, so that's great. Lots from New Zealand, Australia, Japan, India, Spain, I'm seeing, but there's plenty more. So I'll hand back to you, Helena, thanks.
Yeah, and we've been very pleased to see that there have been at least 70 countries viewing today, people from 70 countries. And that's been, it's very exciting to see that we are part of this global family. Many people believe that when we talk about localization, we're talking about retreating into our own little bubble, but this is truly about seeing ourselves as part of one big global family. But in order to actually feel those deep connections to other human beings and to nature, we need to build those local structures where people feel really seen, heard, and connected. And so this is, hopefully this has come across in our program today. So I'd like to invite, first of all, Mika and her husband who has joined us from Tokyo to introduce herself. And if both of you could briefly introduce yourselves.
Okay. Hi, everyone. Hi. My name is Mika Tsutsumi, and I'm so honored to be here with many of you who embrace the localization, commit to the new future. I feel that I'm part of this big family. And I'm an independent journalist and author. I was working for a security company in Wall Street until 9/11 happened at the next building I was working for. And until then, I believed in modern American way of life. You know, faster is the better, winner takes all, reduce the cost, produce more. And I used to believe that tech giant will solve many problems we face in the world. And after 9/11, I realized that it is actually, those things are actually a big part of the problem. So I became a journalist. I quit the Wall Street company and I became a journalist. I started questioning what we have lost in the past half century by meeting people who are living in traditional value in many ways that I used to see as impractical. So I came to realize that there are so many localization movements happening in the world, even though these are not covered by major media, mainstream media. And I realized that, oh, I have to, well, there have to be a new type of localization media for this movement. And I named it as a slow journalism. And so I met many people who know how to reconnect with the nature and reconnect with each other without using AI. And so I joined a movement in Japan connecting these wonderful people, regenerating local food system, regenerating microorganism by fermented food, and promote slow journalism in Japan. So I hope you all enjoy this World Localization Day. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mika. Okay.
Hello, everyone. My name is Ryuhei Kawada, and I'm a member of the House of Counselor in Japan. I'm very happy to meet all of you today. I bet all of you here have an interest in my country, Japan. How many of you know about the lawsuits concerning HIV infection among hemophiliacs, which had a huge impact on the history of healthcare in Japan? That was 1986, and when the AIDS virus arrived on our shores, the entire country panicked, and because terrified of the disease, the media issued exaggerated reports about how patient zero was a gay man who's contracted his sexuality in the United States. And the false information spread, such as if you get infected, you are definitely going to die, and just touching at the skin of an infected person is enough to spread the disease, filtered around, cause everyone in the country to tremble in fear, especially the patients of teenager. In the middle of all this, one day when my mom told me while we were having lunch, I have to inform you that you been infected with HIV. I was only 10 years old. Everything feared black before my eyes. I was still in grade school, so how could I be infected with HIV? I was born with hemophilia, an incurable disease, where the body of difficulty forming blood clots to stop bleeding. And was receiving infected blood products as treatment. One of them was that these were unheated and contaminated with HIV, even though there were reports of HIV contamination in unheated blood products. Japanese pharmaceutical company importing these products didn't want to lose market share to American heated formulation. And so together with the Japanese government, these companies kept the reports secret and continued selling these products. The American pharmaceutical company were also aware of the risks, but still continued to export their stock. These two facts led to my infection with HIV. So, and I don't know.
So since that time, you've also been aware of the power of big business and big pharmaceutical industry, and in the Japanese parliament, you've also been promoting, I understand, localization and local food.
Yes.
Yeah.
Making it go.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you.
So, Ella, would you like to introduce yourself next?
Sure. My name is Eleanor Bancroft. I am an activist, storyteller, mentor, and founder of The Returning. I am also a descendant of the Dajun clan of the Bundjalung Nation, and have spent most of my 20s into my early 30s trying to rediscover my culture. Coming from an Indigenous heritage in Australia, I've looked to refind medicine through bush tucker and rewilding and looking at ways to decolonize. And I think localization is very much on par with decolonization, and really trying to come back to community is what we all need. And I'm a huge advocate for us to be more connected rather than more consuming.
Thank you. Thank you, Ellen. It's wonderful to collaborate with you.
You too.
Damon.
Hi, everyone. My name is Damon Gameau, and I'm a filmmaker. My first film, I looked at the impacts of the food industry, how it's affecting us, that sugar film. And recently, I made a film called 2040, which tries to find some of the best ecological solutions to some of our dilemmas. And I think through making both of those films, I've come to realize that we have some flawed architecture of our system, and that we can't dance around the edges of these various issues. We have to look at the underlying systemic problems that are causing them. And I think more than ever right now, the last 6 months, we've seen our system and its fragility has been laid bare. We're seeing racial unrest. We're seeing income inequality. We've breached our ecological boundaries, that we're coming to the end of a story that we've been telling for quite a while now. So I'm really interested in what that new story is, how we tell that story, whose voices we promote, who are going to be the new voices to tell the story, and how do we come together to make it happen and pivot our system to one that has been extractive and dominating and based on competition and rivalry, to one that is more regenerative, it is more distributive, decentralized, and more interconnected. And I'll be spending the rest of my days trying to make that happen. So I appreciate the opportunity to be here, because I think localization is going to play a key role in the new story that we tell.
Thank you. Manish. Manish, are you there? Manish, do you want to introduce yourself? I think you must be on mute.
Yes, okay, great. Namaste, everyone. So good to be with you today, Helena and entire group of friends. And so happy to be celebrating this day with you, Helena, and with all our friends here. And it's a historical moment, I think, for all of us who have been doing this work for so many years, and particularly for you, who's been an elder and a path leader for all of us. So my name is Manish, and I live in Udaipur, India. And I spent the first half of my life running after the American dream until I started to realize it was a nightmare, not only for me, but for the entire planet. And I worked with on Wall Street and as an investment banker. I have worked with UNESCO and UNICEF. I used to think that getting everyone into school was going to be the solution to solve the world's problems. And I realized actually that factory schooling is one of the major problems for the planet, and is one that is really disconnecting us from ourselves and from our land and from our communities. And is also, you know, feeding us into the consumer unlimited growth paradigm. And for the last 22 years, I have been in India, first trying to heal myself from the violence of the monoculture that is being spread all over the world. And my wife, we learned at the feet of our grandmother's university. So our grandmother and many other village elders helped us in unlearning much of what globalization had conditioned us with. And we have been supporting all kinds of free learning, unschooling, community learning models for kids. And I have recently, in the last few years, been involved with creating several alternative universities and promoting the Ecoversities Alliance. So I'm so happy to be here. We're trying to, I think, the idea is to reimagine education together as part of the way forward for localization. And also, how do we reclaim our cultural imagination, that this idea of Tina, that there is only one alternative, or is there no alternative? How do we challenge that? There's no alternative. And how do we challenge that and go forward, that there are many ways for what the good life is, what we can, how we can think of progress, how we can think of our ways forward as communities and as a planet. So thank you so much. So thrilled to be here with everyone.
Thank you. Manish has been one of our key members of the International Alliance for Localization. So we've been working together for many years now. Now, David, are you there? You're muted. You're muted.
That's right. Okay, can you hear me now?
Yes, we can hear you.
Yes. Okay, yeah, it's a great pleasure to be joining you, Helena, and this distinguished panel for this discussion. I am David Holmgren, the co-originator of the permaculture concept with Bill Mollison back in the 1970s, more than a decade before the sustainability discourse developed in the 80s. Of course, permaculture is a design system for sustainable living and land use. And inherent to its origins were design principles based on how we can live using the design principles of nature and those that can be seen in traditional and indigenous cultures of place before industrial modernity. Not in a retreat to the past, but understanding the underlying principles. And of course, one of those principles is really small and slow solutions. So reflecting the wisdom that came through in E.F. Schumacher's Small is Beautiful, which was one of the influences at the time of developing permaculture. And of course, relocalization was inherently, or localization, relocalization. You see, I am wearing my Hepburn Relocalization Network t-shirt, and behind me are our extended household of three households at Meliodora.
And the Hepburn Relocalization Network is here. Happy solstice to all the world. Solstice here, summer solstice there. It's all for celebration of Localization Day. And we have a song for you as well.
Thank you.
You're about to. Take it away, Charlie McGee.
So for those of you who want a musical introduction to David's work, I've got a song about permaculture, which sums up the ethics. I want to see myself as a part of the whole. Grow some food for my family food bowl. Stand my ground but give up control. Know the boundaries but tear down all the walls. Won't give up or give in to apathy. Gonna plant a tree then plant another 3,000. Now's the time to start feeding your soul. Feeding the soil, believing anything is possible. It's called Earth People Fair.
Love it. And Earth People Fair is one of the highlights of our four-hour program. I love it. I would have had even more of it in there, but the editors...
localization stuff that's in this book, Retro-Suburbia.
So, thank you.
Yeah, I'll be... that is a big theme of my work, as the household, really strong, diverse households rather than fragile households that are based on a single person dependent on the globalized system. So in the relocalization process, a lot of my work, especially in recent times, has been this emphasis on the household level rather than the individual level as the fundamental non-monetary economy that we must rebuild along with, of course, all the localized monetary economies.
Yeah, and And I'll just also quickly say, I mean, I'm in this program quite a lot, so I don't need to say a lot, but I do just want to say that we decided to put this online during COVID, and we felt that COVID had led to a huge shift in thinking that offered opportunities like never before. And our experience now is that it has. It has really shifted consciousness. We're getting enormous amount of interest. I, like Bill Mollison and you, I've been at this since the 70s as well. Mm-hmm. I was also profoundly influenced by Schumacher, and I stuck with that picture of smaller, slower, local. It's all part of a systemic shift. And it's also part of a pluriverse. It's part of understanding the absolute need for diversity. So we're really not looking for one system. We're looking for the principles of reconnection and localization, which will lead to plurality, where real cultural diversity and genuine biodiversity can not only survive, but flourish. I just want to say also that for us, it's very important that we go back and understand that the historical roots of this one monoculture fundamentally was racist, misogynist, and anti-nature. In this system has been a drive to conquer the world, to enslave people, genocide of indigenous people. It's a monstrous system. And what we need to understand is that its foundation was global trade. It was global traders that lifted people across the world, drove people off the land in England, created upheaval, breakdown of community worldwide, and with overt racist values and attitudes. So now here we are today, and maybe the last brick that needs to fall in this system is the understanding of the racial issue. And let's just pray that we can quickly focus on how do we come together to transform this system into something that is a genuinely, genuinely just and treats every single human being as equal, treats all life with respect, and moves us off this precipice that we're still heading towards if we continue to go down a techno-economic path, rather than understanding that the solutions lie with life, genuinely life-affirming path. So that's all I want to say right now. Now we're really looking forward to questions and comments. Don't hesitate to comment. If you have critical comments or questions, we welcome those as well.
So just a note on the questions. I see some of the attendees have their virtual hands raised, but what would be really great is if you can write your question in a concise way in the chat box. I will be keeping an eye on the chat box and extracting the questions from that. So hopefully we'll get to answer as many of them as possible. The first question comes from Maddie, Panna, Luke, Jonah, and Kathy, who are watching this in a little local hub in Sydney. And their question is, how can we ensure localization doesn't come at the expense of reduced knowledge transfer between the global south and the global north? And how do you go about equally distributing resources that cannot be produced locally, like computers and electronics? So straight into the debate side of it, I think.
I'm very happy to answer, but anyone else before me? Manish?
Helena, I think that's a good one.
Yes, okay, thank you. Yeah, so I think the idea of localization is to open up many, many different kinds of knowledges. Gandhi had talked about, learning and knowledge being connected to the head, the hands, the heart, and home. And the kind of modern education system has only focused on the head in a very, very narrow way and put us into this kind of, as Helena was saying, monoculture, but one can further describe it as a overly rational, fragmented, linear, reductionist way of being and seeing the world. And so I think the idea of localization is actually really reconnecting us to the knowledge and the wisdom of our hands, of our bodies, of our land, of our ancestors, of our community. And the diversity of all of these kinds of knowledge is, I think localization helps to unleash that and then become, that creates a platform for actually real knowledge sharing to happen. Otherwise, it has been a one-way dumping on the global south of a certain kind of corporate, industrial, technocratic paradigm. And I think that the work of David and many of the other friends here is actually coming from what shows you what beautifully can happen when we reconnect to kind of the indigenous knowledge and wisdom. And there's so much richness there for us to connect to and share with each other. And what happens when we can also link it to looking at the different challenges that face us right now.
And I guess I would say in terms of the trading in technology and so on, what we're talking about is not eliminating trade. What we're talking about is shifting the emphasis and the subsidies so that global mobile monopolies are not dictating to our governments how to tax and regulate their local and national businesses. They are actually right now the rulers. They are the ones in the climate negotiations who are coming up with narrow ideas like carbon to be traded as a commodity, as a way of dealing with climate change. So we have to move away from a system where the global traders in finance and goods dominate and shape policy, discourse, education, media, all virtually every avenue of knowledge. That doesn't mean that we eliminate trade. So when there is a beneficial transfer of technology, or even if it might be beneficial for two national industries to collaborate internationally, fine. But every business needs to belong to a place, to be localized in order to adhere to the rules of society, rather than society adhering to the rules of global finance and business. It's a very simple, really, idea that I think most people would absolutely agree with if they had stepped back to really study this global economic system and had seen what's actually happening and weren't just listening to a type of shallow, speedy, you know, dogma about free trade and global trade being the way to create jobs and to create wealth.
Helena, if I could add to that, that if we look at it from the other perspective, rather than saying what parts of the economy can't we do at the local scale, and look at when you and I were young, even in the richest, most industrialized countries in the world, like Australia and the United States, a huge part of the real economy was the household and community non-monetary economies. And I'm claiming that in our lifetime, 50% of the growth of GDP has actually not been growth at all. It's just activity has been sucked out of the household and community non-monetary economies into the monetary economies. Sometimes those are initially localized, but then that is vacuumed up by the corporates once it's in the monetary economy. So that clearly when people stopped making their lunch at home and buying lunch when they went to work, no more lunches were created, but it became monetarized. And so we can say that if it's better for the environment, better for community, and better for individuals to move a lot of that activity back down into those non-monetary economies, and that that's part of this whole relocalization process, that it doesn't mean to say we start doing what the Chinese tried to do in the Great Leap Forward of have backyard blast furnaces to make steel.
And this also, I just love working with people who understand that the real economy is the human relationships and the natural resources. Tragically, in the new economy movement, there are many people who get caught up in this idea that if we create local currencies, we want to be sure that they're circulating as much as possible. And they don't realize exactly what you said. No, we don't want to commercialize or to maintain a commercialization of so many relationships, which through millennia, through our whole evolution, were not commercialized. But this has been the goal. We don't realize that we've ruptured relationships from, you know, everything from, you know, breastfeeding to birth to, every attempt has been to intervene with circular relationships to commercialize and break down and to create linear extractive systems instead of these genuinely circular local systems.
And exactly as what Manish was saying, that formalization, institutionalization of education itself, so much of that was replacing the informal in household in community education, which is not monetarized.
Mika, did you want to comment on that too? You're muted.
Yeah, I believe that it's not, it's no longer about between North and South, because even in a developed country, the people desperately need the new way of allocating resources, because otherwise it's not sustainable. And so it's not just from north to south. And now I feel that a lot of people in developed country, they feel that it's they can't go on like that, because we have a resource depletion and it's not sustainable. And then I feel that the new way that the developed country are looking for actually in the wisdom in the South country and the localization. So it has to be connected as a whole in order not to jeopardize the whole world.
Thank you. Ella or Damon, anyone else? Just speak up, unmute yourself. Yes.
Okay, I'll just reiterate that. But for me, I think it's important that we change our thinking to not what we're going to lose by doing this, but how much more we're going to gain, not just for ourselves, but for the planet and for our children and the next generations. And I think it's time that, like, we look at how this isn't a sacrifice, but a giant leap forward for all of us together to do it.
Damon, did you want to comment too? No, Damon, did you want to comment? You're muted. I don't know if people are self-muting or if you're getting muted. Can't hear you. No. Okay, so next question.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, now I can hear you.
Yeah. So I needed to be taken off mute. I was trapped in my own computer.
Oh, I see.
I think I'll just quickly add that I think it's important to understand that when we're talking about the sort of the North and South, that for people that aren't aware, there are lots of impediments to the Global South actually doing what they should be. There's something called predatory lending, which is IMF, World Bank, other countries as well, lend some of these countries huge amounts of money, but then take a lot of their natural resources and assets as a sort of as a protection in case they can't pay their loan back. And this is causing all sorts of, it's like holding the hand on the head of these countries. So unless we undo that, wipe some of this debt and allow those countries to spend the money on these types of initiatives that we're talking about, free them up, we're not going to move anywhere forward with these ideas. So it's very important to understand the rule of the game that inhibits these kind of countries stepping up and doing some of these things.
Thank you. More questions?
Okay. Yeah. So many questions coming in. It's almost unmanageable, but I'm getting there. This is an interesting question from Jade. I guess this question is directed to David, but they'd love input from others too. How do you balance the urgency and magnitude of the issue and change needed with the principle of slow and small and local solutions?
Yes, well, there's an assumption that systems grow by just inflating in size, whereas cellular reproduction produces, if you like, the potential for viral spread of positive organisms in small ways that are connected to where they are, but they are reproducing. So, for example, if we have a productive food garden and someone with knowledge as a gardener in place, then natural spin-offs of that come from seed and other things that can be spread when the conditions are right. So, for example, within the recent pandemic, there's a huge number of people who suddenly saw an existential reason to actually grow their own food. Now, of course, those things are still limited, that you can't fast track the growing seasons and, you know, the whole skill build up. But the motivation and the possibility of viral spread of small systems that can actually be fast at some collective scale. But the difference with large scale systems is when you're on some path where there's an error, then you make big mistakes quickly. Whereas this reproductive process, there's always an evolutionary mutation, iteration, change, adaptation. So you get a learning cycle that happens with these small systems. So rather than, you know, the one big solution replicated everywhere, there's a process of change that, and each of those changes might be incremental adjustments. And of course, anyone who's connected to the land knows that every situation is different, requires slightly different situation, different responses. So yes, it can look like a contradiction, but the dominant paradigm that says there's one big solution that suddenly will deal with anything, like everything, like just cover the world with solar panels and wind turbines and we'll be right. All of those ideas are out of the thinking which created the problem. That doesn't mean to say that some things don't need to happen fast, but a lot of the things that need to happen the fastest are the things we need to stop doing.
Exactly. Maybe we should take some more questions since there's so many, Henry.
Yep, there are many indeed. All right. So we have questions on actually the process of change making, which is super important, from a few different people. Taz in Pune, India says, how do I start a local movement?
Hmm. Manish, are you there? Maybe Manish, you could.
In an urban city like Pune, India, where do I start?
So Manish, please start. Oh, well.
Sorry. Okay. Maybe I was cutting out a bit, but I was just going to put a few questions in that are on the same topic. The system is so big and powerful. How are we really going to transform it? How are we constructively interacting with the old system and creating a new system? And do we go into politics? Questions coming up around that. So those are from Rieta and Mick. So yeah, go take it away.
Manish, do you want to, again, you're muted. Can you unmute yourself? Henry, are you muting people?
Thank you. Yeah, I just wanted also just say one thing on the last question too, is that, it's related. I think that part of what's needed as we think about how to deal with these things urgently is coming back to context. The idea that context matters. You know, and how whatever we do, we need to look at our relationships with our biosystems, and even more with that, the sense of sacred that we, how we connect to these things, how we see these things. Many, you know, communities, indigenous communities, they have been saved, but we have been trained into seeing all of our biosystems as commodities. And how do we shift that, I think, is where we need to urgently think of and work on that. And also look at context much more seriously. Like, you know, when we got into whether it's globalization or even nationalism, both of these different ways of development have actually ignored context, you know, and have worked to the detriment of context. So I think that one of the things is to come back to that. And our entire education system, you know, we learn about the Eiffel Tower in Paris, and we learn about, but we don't know what about our, where is our own local water coming from, or where, who's growing our food, or what's happened to our forests in the last 50 years. So all of those things somehow need to come back into center stage as we move forward. So, and in terms of how to build a local movement, I think I would, personally, I mean, we are encouraging people to start up their own local ecoversities. Let's create a space where people who really want to build that movement can come together and learn. They can learn about much of the work of local futures, you know, big picture activism, understand where are we? And there's a lot of, you know, Helena, you and I talk a lot with many of our friends, lots of fake solutions being promoted all over. And they end up feeding into the same techno-industrial military paradigm at the end of the corporate paradigm. So how do we actually understand the big picture things, and how do we come together and start to work on real everyday issues that that matter in our communities, and start to involve people in that? Whether, and I think the easiest one, which I think all, most of the panelists would agree with, is growing your own food, starting to grow your own food. And food, and at least in India, you'll know that we are essentially foodies. So people love food. And so food festivals, you know, growing our own food, this is the way to bring people together, I think, very easily. Food and music is, I think, the simplest, most profound technologies we have for building community and for starting this movement.
And if I could just add, I think it's also not just about everyone growing their own food, but it's about helping to collaborate so that there are regional and localized food systems, so that yes, those who might be living in a more urban setting link up with the growers and the farmers in the region, and wherever possible, with the help of permaculture and so on, grow as much as possible in their own gardens. But yes, in order to really feed the world, we need to look at that collaboration yeah, between.
I think, you know, we say in Udaipur, we say, you know, we know our doctors and we know our accountants, but how come we don't know our farmers anymore? So actually building relationships with them again is very critical. And also I do feel that even growing anything in your home is crucial. If you really want to connect back to even a, you know, one plant, which is a, you know, giving you some fruit or some, you know, eggplant or, you know, chili peppers or coriander, something growing that again is a very simple way to reconnect us to our spirit back into the sacred nature of life.
Ella, you look like you might want to say something about that.
Yeah, I think it's I don't know, for me it's just it's an unraveling of deep programming, and really a reclaiming of who we are as human beings. And I think that the core morals and values in our societies are a little skewed, and that we have been led down a false path of success and seeing things like, you know, money and business as what to strive towards, rather than looking for connection, deep community and land-based skills and a really deep connection and healthy lifestyle as a form of success. So I think, like, first it starts with us changing our mindset, and then in terms of trying to grow the movement, educate people, you know, but that starts with us doing the work first and then bringing people along on that journey.
Thank you. Any other comments?
Well, I've answered that question within the permaculture movement, where people so often have asked, how do we get everyone else on board with this? And I've said, well, the first thing is to be our own guinea pigs. If these permaculture ideas of self-reliance and everything are good, let's show that they're good and let's demonstrate that. And one of the things that comes out of that experience is, this is hard to do as a single person. Even as a couple, this is quite difficult. There is a huge number of skill sets and there are things called economies of scale, but most of our things in the globalized economy are way too big. But ironically, our households, especially in the Western world, are mostly too small to be economically viable in this holistic way. So we do need households where, yeah, there's someone who can fix things and there's someone who's the household nurse and there's someone who grows some vegetables. And suddenly a huge range of things become possible to do. So in this way, we can be modelling firstly at that level, and then when we connect more widely in community, then we are coming from at least what we are talking about at the household scale as we build that next very important scale at the community scale.
Any other comments?
I'm actually not muting people. I don't know, maybe we have a Zoom poltergeist or something doing it. But yeah, sorry, Damon, you wanted to say something before?
No, all good.
Okay. A few interesting questions coming up from Nick and from Amelie about the possibility of the far right infiltrating the localization movement. So, and Nick phrased it as, how do we prevent the emerging interest in localization becoming co-opted by extreme right-wing actors in our communities, people who would exploit this to advance nationalism?
Anyone else? Or should I go? I don't want to speak too much, but yeah, I think people who talk about this similarity between localization and nationalism are really not looking at what localization is about. They are vested interest in the media that portray Trump as a localist, portray him as someone who's anti-corporate, anti-free trade. He is a greedy businessman, corporate, pro-trade when it suits him, but it's quite convenient to undermine the grassroots movement, which is genuinely about how do we restore biodiversity, community, localized food systems. And I would maintain that when you have strong, healthy community and local economies, you are not vulnerable to the machinations of demagogues that have an absolute, field day. Once people have been uprooted, community destroyed, people are there isolated, individualized, living in fear of not having a job or a livelihood, it's very easy to manipulate them into this nationalist identity, which has been shaped as part of the war machine. And so as far as we're concerned, nationalism and localism are not only different, but diametrically opposed. And as I say, it's been with the breakdown of the community fabric and the breakdown of strong local economies that people have been so easily manipulated.
Elaine, I'll just jump in quickly. I would say that it also, I've come across this a little bit myself, and I would say there's also an opportunity to find common ground. I'd be loath to just cast and dismiss someone because they have a far-right view and can be seen as just wanting nationalism. I think that we are seeing a shift to the right around the world because people are feeling disempowered at a local level. They are craving, they're sick of decisions being made from corporations a long way away. They want a strong man to represent them. So there's an opportunity there to actually find some common ground and reach out and say, hey, I relate to that. And here's what we can build together. Here's this stronger community that we both want, we both value. We might have to just tweak a few things around the edges, but there is the opportunity to find common ground. And I think it's a really important moment to do that because we're not getting many opportunities to find common ground at the moment. And that's a really important one.
Yeah, although I would say, you know, if their call is for the strong demagogue, we're actually not agreeing. I think what I see is a rejection of big government, because that's what people see, and they don't realize that big government, national government, has become an arm of this corporate system. And so they're angry at that. They want more power at the local level. So we absolutely have common ground in talking about how do we restore power and real economic activity at the local level. And I think there's, like you say, there's a huge opportunity, because across left and right, there are these values of family, community. Even as we try to raise the status of farmers, there's a huge opportunity in the so-called right, far-right communities. I completely agree.
I'd agree there too. In my experience living in a small community, which is very diverse in you know, what we call progressive environmental thinking and old rural right-wing Australian thinking. Someone who's just died, who was a senator representing Victoria, John Madigan, a local man, very passionate about support for local manufacturing and farmers, very genuine person, socially conservative, Catholic. I disagreed with him about wind farms, but we had those discussions and there was more agreement between us than disagreement.
And what about in Japan? Do you see a similar pattern, Mika? Again, you're on mute. Can you unmute yourself? Yes, okay. Yeah.
Yes, we have the same problem in Japan. And but like Damon says, it's very important that we have to have, we have to find a way to have a common ground to talk to them, because we really need a diversity in this movement. And also from a journalist point of view, I think we have to be very careful that mainstream media always use tactics to divide the movement between right and left. And a lot of times it's very disillusioned, and it's very, you know, they really made it because so we can, you know, we cannot do the movement together. We have to be
polarized. Yeah.
And I've seen a lot of many scene of that. Many local movements in Japan are divided and jeopardized because of being divided from right and left. So we have to be aware of that. It's always their way to stop us as well.
Yeah, and we see these divisions also across gender and,
across gender and then the color of the skin, everything. They can use everything to divide us.
Yeah. Mm. Ella, did you want to say something about that too?
No, I'm okay.
Okay.
Yeah. There's a lot of questions around education and around reaching people with this message, that particularly questions from the global south about how to debunk those values that are, you know, attached, that global and the imported with a higher status. How do we re-educate around that? And also, how do we, at a more fundamental level, embed these values and these understandings in our education systems?
Mm-hmm. Well, I think it starts with this sort of what I'm calling big picture activism, so that if we can help to get real life stories out of the number of people supposedly in these rich, happy countries where people have everything. Give them reality stories. Let them hear also from people like Russell Brand and all kinds of people talking about what it was like to go way to the top, famous, Hollywood, rich, beautiful, and it was completely empty. Those stories do not reach it. They're because of the media again. So we need again to understand how important it is for us to share stories and to create alternative avenues for communicating this real world information both ways.
Yeah, I would say I tried for many years to bring these ideas into the formal education system. And I think that there is a fundamental problem with the design of the education system. So we talk about, you know, the same people who designed the factory system, the army system, and the prison system, that's the same thinking that has gone into making this education system. So I don't think that it's enough, given where we are right now, as communities and as a planet, it's not enough to think we can just sprinkle a little bit localization on top of things and everything is going to go. We need a much more fundamental reimagining of the education system. And I can offer a few elements. I think that first and foremost, we need to bring, again, a space for deep intergenerational interactions in our design. You know, like I think one of the conditions, at least for wisdom to emerge, is to have at least three generations meaningfully interacting with each other. We cannot just think, okay, let's call in, and it's not a tokenism I'm talking about. Once a year, call in some grandmother and say, okay, now we had our intergenerational interaction. It's actually redesigning a space where that is central to that. The second thing is we sometimes talk about, you know, we saw that kids that are growing up in cities, they grow up seeing products. And actually kids who are in villages and real communities, they see processes. How are things being made? What's the connection to our natural systems? What's our connection to our river? And what's our connection to our sacred mountain? And all of those things. So I think, again, putting kids in a box all day and telling them, okay, read a story about your sacred mountain, or it doesn't work. They have to be building active live connections. They have to know also the things they use every day. Where is it coming from? How is it made? What goes into it? This should be a very, in 21st century, this should be a fundamental question. Whatever I'm using, how is it made and who's making it? Are things we need to ask, and where is it being made, you know? So I think that, you know, there are many, many areas that we can look at, but there needs to be really redesigning of the whole system. It's not just, I don't think we can just add on one or two things and say, you know, like in India, there are some people who are doing something around, they've developed a happiness curriculum. So they do, you know, one period of a week, you get one, you know, 45 minutes of happiness, and the rest of the, you know, 100 and some hours, you're tortured by the same stressful, you know, competitive, overburdening and disconnecting education system. So I think that, you know, we need to also call out some of these fake solutions and really invite something much more deeper. And we have, I think it starts with, we have to, you know, faith in our own, you know, community resources. We have so many sources in our communities, every single community. You know, I go to a favela in Brazil, or if I go to a village in India, I am overwhelmed with how much talent, how much knowledge, how much resources exist within those communities. And if you give a space and develop spaces, they will lead the way, actually, for what this movement should be.
And also, I do want to add, even in the Western world, those skills and those are maybe absolutely harder to find, because people have been robbed of them for much longer. But we have found in the localization movement that once people start looking around and start realizing how much can be done by people, that it's remarkable.
Yeah, I think the sickness is that we keep looking for some outside, you know, corporate experts to come and tell us, or UN experts to tell us how to do things. But yet that knowledge is so rich in many of our communities. So creating platforms really where that can start to flow is essential.
Maybe I could comment on the development of environmental education in Australia. And of course, permaculture has been part of that, the development of school gardens and a lot of these things, which I would say there's been some positives there, but I see them as remedial. They are substitutes for the real environmental education, which is informal, a lot of it unregulated by the adult world, where children are not absorbing whatever the limitations of initially the cultural paradigm that they're in. So that exploratory, direct childhood exploratory, which now children in the Western world are most deprived of, and unfortunately within the regulatory sort of risk-averse structure of schools, a lot of that most informal, low-cost and yet most valuable stuff can't be done. So a lot of the role of permaculture people working in these spaces is to sort of try and subvert and loosen up those spaces to the extent possible, and then of course encourage other forms to take over, which don't cost a lot of money and can be done anywhere and everywhere where there's a connection to nature. And obviously that's harder to do in high density cities than it is in lower density places.
I also just quickly want to say there is quite an important difference here between this more industrialized and less industrialized countries. In the less industrialized countries, the older generation still has so much to teach. In the industrialized world, usually the older generation was indoctrinated into this fossil fuel-based corporate system. And so they're often, you know, they're more resistant to that creative change that comes from youngsters. But in the so-called third world, we have to be careful that we don't ignore that very important difference.
I'd agree with that there also, but I'm also seeing the seeds, Helena, of people of our generation who did at some level understand the problem when we were young, and then they just got totally absorbed back into the system. And now as older people are saying, what the hell is the world that my grandchildren coming into? And there's a new radicalization or coming back out of the box.
Yes, thank goodness. Thank goodness.
A small result from, you know, the much larger thing that we hoped for back in the 60s.
Yes. Mika, did you want to say something? Muted again. Can you unmute? Yes.
Can you hear me?
Yes, now I can hear you.
Oh, okay. I think changing the education system is very important. And what my husband and I are trying to commit right now is changing the school lunch into organic, because the food in the modern world, especially in the developed country, children are eating a lot of chemicals and petro-industrial food. And that has a lot to do with the way they think, and their focus is much shorter than before because of what they are eating. So we have to change what they eat, because they have no choice. And only adult can change what children are eating, either parents or the teachers or local government can do that. But that has that puts a lot of influence of how they view the world. So we're trying to change the school lunch into organic and put the edible garden in every school, so children can grow their own food. In that way, they are naturally learning how to respect other living things, and they can and that has a lot to do that's very good for the small farmers, local farm. And second thing I'm worried about is that especially under the COVID-19, many governments, including Japan, including the Japanese government, are trying to centralize the school and change it into online education. You know, the connecting children with children and then teachers with tech. And then tech giants has collaborated with the government and tried to start online school, but that's really opposite to what we're trying to do with the localization. So we have to be very careful that mainstream media are showing and covering that online school as a wonderful thing for children. But I have a huge doubt on that.
Absolutely, it's exactly the opposite. And it's, you know, it's online, you know, currency, digital money. It's that's the fork in the road that we have to be really, really careful about. Damon, do you want to say something also about, Damon has succeeded, I think, to change some policies, at least in terms of sugar, which is of course also part of this corporate diet, the chemicals and the sugar, which is disastrous for children.
I just think that the children are so crucial, that they are born, as we all are, with this innate understanding of nature and our connection to it, and then the system erodes it from them. So I think we have a responsibility to prioritize nature into that education, to give them tangible experiences, not just laptop experiences, but get them out, let them feel the soil under their feet, hold trees, interact with them, let them actually feel the power of it. Because I think what we're dealing with here is a battle of metaphors right now, that the metaphor we used to have, or traditional cultures had, were very different to ours now. Ours is extraction, that's our metaphor. We had custodianship, we had reverent guests of the land with the Chinese. And unless we redefine that metaphor again, I don't think we're going to get through this. And that starts with the children. That if you get that metaphor right, then the education system, all systems, fan out from that core foundational architecture. And I think we can talk around this issue all we like, we can try all these things, but if we don't address the fundamental flaw of our functionality, then we're never going to get through this. And it's a big task, it's a big challenge, but I think it's up to all of us. What are we contributing to this collective hive mind we've created? Are we telling the new story and sharing ideas and inspiring people? Or are we getting stuck in the old paradigm? Are we stuck in these limbic system reactions that the media want us to do, keep us divided? We're getting so bogged down. We're arguing about what is true and what isn't true. The truth is all around us. The truth is the soil. The truth are the trees. The truth is the air we breathe. That's what we should be fighting for. And that's what we should be teaching our children.
I think it's crucial that we also recognize that education was brought in as a factory training for this economic system that we need to change. So the fundamental link between the economy and education all the time has to be recognized. So we need to really see this holistic, inextricable connection. And again, for us, localizing is precisely the path where we can reconnect with nature in terms of education and the economy.
Can I just add something?
Yes, please.
The education system, you know, sometimes it can seem so daunting how to get in there, how to actually make change. But I see this as a perfect opportunity for people to see alternative education, or to create alternative education programs, events, you know, like seek the knowledge if it isn't being provided, and especially for your children.
Manish is gesturing that he should be unmuted. It's definitely the poltergeist. It's not me.
Oh, sorry. I actually, just for a sound improvement, mute myself, Henry, and then that's why I have to confess. Sorry. I just want to say something else, just adding to what Ella, is that this is a great time. Lots of people are thinking about taking a gap years from this formal system. I think this is something that we should really be encouraging. We have a movement in India called the walkouts, walk-on movement. So it's an active, we need to bring in active forms of civil disobedience with this education system. I resigned from UNESCO 22 years ago because I have no faith that those who are running the system are ever going to want to create a system that values the land, that values nature, that values people, that values life. That is not the intention of what this system. If that system started to actually happen in front of them, they would block it, and they do repeatedly block it, and that because that would challenge this entire global economic machinery. So it's not in the interests of those holding the education strings to actually allow any serious attempts to rethink the fundamental monoculture thinking that is being built by that system. So I would just say I feel very passionate about this, but we need to stop fooling ourselves that these little things here and there are actually, we need to encourage young people and their families to escape, to walk out of this system and actually walk back. The real learning is in our communities and is in nature.
So there are a lot of comments and questions in the chat box about how to connect and how to get more involved. So I'm just going to repeat what I said at the beginning, which is that on our World Localization Day website, you can join the International Alliance for Localization and also check out our pledge. We have a take a pledge thing where you can pledge action, and we have suggestions of action on there so that you can do. So please check that out. And yeah, keep these conversations going through the IAL forum. There's a lot of questions about policy and about, it kind of very much ties in with what Manish is saying, walk out, walk on, but also how do we, to what extent do we engage with policymakers and the business community versus not working within this system? To what degree is that important? There's also questions about the role of global institutions such as the UN, the WHO and the WTO. So how do we get that balance right?
Who would like to have a go? I'll try to be quick. First of all, it can sound extremely daunting to be told you've just got to walk out, you know, as Manish is saying. So we are urging everyone to start as the first step to reconnect or to connect with some like-minded people in the area where you live. So we're trying to encourage the creation of sort of local hubs of people who can support each other. Because as David was saying, you know, in our little households, we're cut off, we're in this little nuclear family. We need to open those doors. We need to have a bigger we, change the I to a we. As a group that's rethinking our possibilities now, recognizing that we're standing before enormous, frightening changes, and that we really need to sort of, as it were, hurry up to come up with meaningful systemic responses. Doing it as a we is incredibly empowering. We urge people then as the next step to take a deep breath and just step back and recognize that we do need to be taking as big steps as we can. But the important thing is that we understand how we often in unconscious ways support and feed the system that is taking us over the brink, that is systematically destroying biodiversity, community and democracy, just to mention a few. So what are the steps we can take collectively as this local group, as this local hub? Then we're seeing that once people connect in that way, they feel a sense of empowerment. They've already changed it to a we, and you can then allocate tasks to different people. Some people can be studying more. What are the things that are happening around the world that we can connect with and learn from? How can we spread out and become part of bigger networks? We believe that the important thing is that we at the grassroots start being much clearer about what kind of policy change we want. And in order to do that in an intelligent way, we need to understand the global system much better than we have been allowed to do. We have not received any information in our education or in the media about how power has been concentrating at the global level. A lot of people know they don't like big business, but they have not known that the trade treaties have been the path, particularly in the last 35 years, whereby these corporations and banks have been gaining more and more and more power. Once we shed the light on that, we're starting to get the beginnings of a dialogue that hopefully in a few years would translate into a demand for policy change. We right now would not recommend people to go into politics. We would recommend them to pressure upwards at the level of mayors, local governments, where we do see some political change now around the world. Because at that level, our political representatives are still being forced to represent us a lot more than people at the national level, who are being so pressured by big money from outside that they've become you know, they're representing that money, not us. And many good people who go into politics, go up that ladder, disappear in that cloud of financial speculation and in a haze of numbers. And they start believing that, yes, more trade, more growth is what's going to solve our problems. So politics and policy start with us being clearer about what we want and then try to link across left, right, environmental, social, across all these divides that are being created to together come up with clarity about key elements that we want to change.
Elena, I think what helps there too is that sometimes it's easy to put these labels on, you know, corporation bad, bank evil, but we forget that there are humans within those institutions, and a lot of those humans are feeling the same that we are, and they feel a little bit trapped by the system. They want change. They've got children. So we are actually much larger in number than we actually understand sometimes. And I think, again, when we create this system that is based on domination and competition, if you're very good at that, you show little empathy, you can get to the top, you can accrue huge amounts of wealth, you can then set the rules of the game. So there's actually only a minority of people at that very top level that are setting the rules of this game. There is a huge majority of us that are altruistic and do want a better system that serves all living systems. So I find that incredibly comforting. I've met many of them now in screening the film, CEOs of certain banks and corporations that have said, what do? We want to change. We don't know what to do yet, but at least that conversation is open for the first time in a long time. And I think we should all be comforted by that. And again, the more we can humanize and not demonize these people, even when they're in these institutions, we're going to have a better chance of bringing them along and making the changes that we need to make.
I completely agree with that. I see at those levels, absolutely human beings who are often kind and often very intelligent, but I see them trapped once they go up the ladder in a systemic prison where they are virtually incapable of doing the right thing. And I so agree with you that it's not a question of good guys and bad guys, but what it is a question of good structures and bad structures. And unfortunately, if you try to talk to them about, let's change those trade treaties, let's start regulating the giants, I'm afraid that most of them will be afraid to speak out. And it's going to come more from the bottom, that people will actually start speaking the truth. So until now, I don't know of a single publicly traded corporation that's doing the right thing. And I hear a lot of good language from them. And there are good people inside, whether it's Unilever or Monsanto or Coca-Cola, there are good people inside. But as a structure, what they're doing is evil. And they are not evil as people. And I think this distinction between the structure and the individual is vital also at the grassroots. We have to get away from this politics of identity, of individuals. Let's look at what is the vision? What do we stand for? What are we really trying to accomplish?
The way I look at those relationships between power to act is that, as you said, the higher up you go, the more power a person can appear to wield, but they are in a straitjacket. So their options to move become just incredibly constrained. Whereas at the bottom, as an individual, at least in the affluent world, we have an enormous freedom to act. We can choose to live to an amazing extent however we want, if we are brave and bold enough and prepared to not, you know, need the reinforcement of media or even community. The first level where we gain greater power to influence things but are more constrained by compromise is the household. And whether that's a family or whatever it is of people shared living, there is an increase in power capacity. And then, of course, when we go to the community level and local government, there's a much greater power. But of course, there's the processes of constraint. And I think those first three levels, really the household, the community and local government, that I agree is the sweet point for action, because what has to be done is very different from what is being done, and therefore it requires maximum freedom to act, not maximum power.
Yeah. Any other comments on that? Mika?
Okay. I agree with you guys. I think a local assembly is one of the most powerful tool for localization movement because right now, like in Japan, a member of parliament are very close to big corporation. They need a lot of money for election. So, and also the big corporation goes to visit them all the time, while a lot of us are very indifferent and give up on politics. So that makes things worse for us. So I'm always telling, letting people know that go to the local assembly, because usually people don't even talk to them, don't even visit them. Only time they access to the local assembly is that during election for 2 weeks. But between election and election, they don't even go talk to them. But meanwhile, corporation go talk to them. So I say, go talk to local assembly about localization or what kind of society you wanna raise your children. Because the local assemblies are usually local people. So you know them, you know their family, you know their children, you know where they went to school. So it's easier for us to get connected with local assembly compared to the member of the parliament. I'm talking about example of Japan, but I believe that a lot of countries are the same way. And then in Japan, like for example, many women go to local assembly and start changing, let's say school lunch for organic. And they can do it because it's a small scale. And once you get to the small scale and get things done, you get more confident and you get more access and connection to the politics. In that way, a lot of women started to becoming more active, politically active and under the COVID-19, because their voice, they couldn't get their voice reached to the member of the parliament, but local assembly listened to them. So they started connecting with them. And then once local assembly start changing it, they can make a small change in local way. And then this seems to be longer way, but it's not. It's actually a shortcut, because a lot of small local assembly change, make a small change in everywhere in the country. What happened is that when the election comes, the National Assembly, member of the parliament needs local assembly to get reelected. So get connection with the local assembly is very, very important, because a lot of times localization movement, I see a lot of people, they want new change for the new future, but they give up on politics.
Yeah.
We have to be active, politically active. Otherwise, it's not going to be happening.
Well, this is also what I said earlier. We are seeing that as a global pattern, that there is a way in which at the local level, even at the level of mayors of big cities, that there is a response, you know, because there is again more of that face-to-face connection, right. And they're forced to see the impact on the land, on people, of their policies. Whereas at the top, they really are, that's all hidden by a haze of numbers, of statistics. And, mm-hmm. and you know, it's an abstract concept that people are dealing with.
Well, can I add one more thing?
Yeah.
I'm sorry, can I add one more thing? And also go to the local media instead of mainstream media, because the local media, they're very struggling, but they are more attached and they have more compassion to localization, local mothers. But, you know, just because they're struggling, but that doesn't mean they cannot be connected with us. And the local media can be a very powerful tool for us.
Especially if we understand that, you know, if we make a concerted effort, I totally agree with you. And of course, a lot of the local media is threatened, but as part of this movement, we need to be aware of either to protect it or to create it again, because it's being, you know, with pressure from above, destroyed. I think that's a very important point. Did anyone else want to comment on that? We're getting close to the end now. No? So we take, oh, it's so late, we better wrap it up then. So any final comments from anybody? Damon, did you want to say something?
I guess, William Davies had this beautiful quote. He said that to experience a crisis is to inhabit a world that is temporarily up for grabs. And I think we have a very unique opportunity right now to amplify these ideas, to put out these radical suggestions, because people are open for the first time in a long time. And we are seeing some incredible changes going on behind the scenes. So I would encourage everyone to be bold and put this stuff out there, because the fragility of our current system has been laid bare, and people are now talking about resilience and planting their own food and decentralizing their energy in a legitimate way for the first time. So everyone on this call understands this, is passionate about this topic. So I would encourage everyone to shout louder than you've ever shouted, with kindness and with a human touch, because this is a unique moment and a unique opportunity for all of us.
Thank you. Anyone else want to say some final words? We've got just a minute or so left. Yes, David.
I was just going to say Retro Suburbia, which for us is much more than a book. It's really the third level of development in the permaculture movement, is been growing very rapidly as a result of, in Australia initially, with a very local focus, but that is extending through networks. But as a result of the pandemic, we had, for example, people joining the Retro Suburbia Community Facebook page go from 5,000 to 11,000 in one month, after 5 years of growth to that point. Mm. And those seedings back into people discovering other people in their neighbourhood, with sort of structuring those processes to try and make sure that the online tools don't vacuum everything into just the network world, but re-help seed people connected to people in their local area.
Well, it's really wonderful. And I hope people will remember to let everybody they know about World Localization Day, this program we put together, you know, more than 4 hours, more than 100 voices from all over the world, from every continent, we see as a very important repository and tool that can help to strengthen this movement worldwide. It's going to be up online now for a week, so please do let people know, and it will come back up again. We're going to need to make some changes, and we'll see about the future. And I think we're going to be adding more voices, because we've had so much interest. There's so many people who have woken up to this importance, and this paradoxical thing that in order to go truly global, in order to truly feel ourselves part of this universal, absolute, inextricable connection to life, this experience of that is local. And once we feel that deep spiritual connection, that oneness, that's when we truly feel part of the human family. We believe that having become fragmented and uprooted from the land, uprooted from any form of community, and rushing around in this mobile and ever faster rat race, that's somehow globalizing us as human beings and creating some giant global family. It's had exactly the opposite effect. in slowing down and localizing and reconnecting, that we suddenly open up to life, which is that universal oneness, and where we feel secure enough to be completely not just unthreatened by diversity, but we welcome diversity once we feel secure and connected ourselves. So I love all of you so much. All of you are friends and colleagues, and I'm so grateful for all of you and everything that you're doing. And I hope we'll be able to reconnect more online and support each other as we go forward. It's not going to be easy times, but I think we all feel that there is this absolutely new opportunity, as Damon was saying. It's a very important opportunity, and it's one that we all need to, you know, we can't slow down. We need to speed up in order to be able to slow down. And partly what we need to speed up to a great extent is clarity and resistance to continuing down that path of bigger, faster, more competitive, to be able to embrace that slowing down and that scaling down. That is who we are. That is operating at a human and ecological pace. It corresponds to our innate needs. Thank you all so much. And thank you, Henry, for helping us.
Thank you, Helena. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you. Thank you, Helena.
Thank you, Helena.
Bye-bye.
Bye, everyone.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye, everyone. Thanks so much.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Ну, полёт.